Come on, let's lift up the name of Jesus Christ. There is none other in heaven or on earth. Welcome to another episode of Hope in Christ with Denise, here on Kingdom Influencers Broadcast, where we place our hope in the only hope there is, Christ our Lord.
All right. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome back to Hope in Christ with Denise here on Kingdom Influencers Broadcast. I am your host, Pastor Denise, and thank you all for joining us this evening. We have a phenomenal panel discussion that we will be having today live, and it'll also air on the podcast. And the panel discussion will be called Resolutions versus Christ's Direction. So we have two phenomenal women of God that will be coming up shortly. But before we begin, I'm going to open us up with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you, oh God, for this time. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you, Lord God, that you are God. And we pray, oh God, that those that are listening, those that will hear the playback of this, God, that they would listen to your direction, oh God. And that, Lord, we would know that it is by your plan and your plan alone that you have purposed us in the earth. So we pray, Father, for those that are listening to us, that you would open up their heart, that they would open their hearts unto you, O God, and that we all would seek your direction in this hour. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, thank you all for tuning in to Hope in Christ with Denise here on Kingdom Influencers Broadcast. Again, I'm your host, Pastor Denise, and I welcome you to Hope in Christ Ministries. Remember, at Hope in Christ, we are healthy, overcomers, we have purpose, and we maintain an eternal perspective in Christ Jesus, our Lord. So without further ado, we're going to bring on, the two women of God that will introduce themselves first, and then we will jump into our discussion. And remember, our discussion today is resolutions versus Christ's direction. And when we're talking about that, if you have any questions or you have any comments, please place them in the comment section. So today we have Pamela, and Pamela's going to tell us a little bit about herself before we begin.
Hello, everyone. I am Minister Pamela Johnson. I live in Fredericksburg, Virginia. I am a minister, as I said. I'm also a guest blogger for Hope in Christ Ministries. I've been blessed with that opportunity. And I've been co-author on an anthology through the Christian Book Lovers Retreat in 2019. I made that launch into formally writing or officially writing, and just sharing my testimony of basically how God brought me out of a toxic relationship, marriage, if you will, through separation and divorce, and raising my three sons. And it's just been a blessing to be on this journey. I appreciate Minister Denise for giving me these opportunities, and God has just been blessing. And I'm just glad to be here on tonight.
Amen. Thank you, Pamela, for joining us. And then we have another guest, a phenomenal woman of God. Keandria is going to introduce herself.
Hello, everyone. I'm blessed to be among you all tonight. My name is Keandria Wilson, and I am the author of Life at a Glance and the co-author of Meant for My Good. I'm also the coach of Empowerment Online Training, where I work with Christian professional women, helping them to just break barriers, any burnout, work overwhelm, help set life boundaries, and just develop personally and professionally. And I'm here in Knoxville, Tennessee, and I look forward to the healthy conversation tonight.
Amen, amen. Thank you, ladies, for joining us. So we're going to jump right in to our discussion. So again, those that are tuning in, those that will listen to the replay, the title is Resolutions versus Christ's Direction. So we're going to talk about the very first question that we have. And it's a general question. And that question is, why do we make resolutions in general? So we're going to ask Keandra to answer that one first, and then we'll have Pamela to respond. So the first question, again, is why do we make resolutions in general?
Well, one reason is from one year to the next, we make resolutions because we often want a new start. You often hear people say restart, just reset, revive. It's just a new beginning.
I think that usually we make resolutions because we want to make some type of improvement in our life, whether it's that losing weight, saving money, reading the Bible more intently, but usually it's geared toward an improvement or a positive action.
I agree, ladies. And a lot of times we make those resolutions and Lord knows, we start off strong and then we don't always carry it out. And so the second question that we have, in the past, have you made a resolution that you didn't stick to or it didn't work out? Have you made a resolution that you didn't stick to? And I can start with that answer. I probably made a lot of resolutions that I didn't stick to. One of them, I would say probably was, you know, making sure that I eat better, lose weight, those kind of things. And especially when the pandemic started, you like start snacking and all kind of stuff start happening. So that's I would say one example. And, you know, maybe changing the way that I did something was another resolution. But sometimes you go back into that same mode of doing things. And so I think those two definitely have been examples for me. So Pamela, I know if you wanted to answer that question.
I think sometimes the reason why we don't stick to the resolution is because we make it too big, or we make it, it's not realistic or attainable. Say your example of losing weight, for me, it was fitness. And it's like my trainer, I work with a trainer a couple of days a week, but I'm intentional about doing that. I know I have that appointment. I know that I'm gonna follow through. But when I first met him, he asked me, why am I coming to see him? We didn't do the first exercise, we had a conversation. He said, if your why isn't enough to bring you back after each session, then you're just wasting your time and mine as well. So we have to make it something that we will actually pursue or reach after. And so one meal at a time, one workout at a time, one decision at a time, not, you know, make it so big that we can't reach it. Just take everything by that intentional steps that we take.
Amen. Amen. And Keandra, did you want to add to that?
Go ahead. Does she have more to say?
Mm-mm. No, I'm good.
Okay. But yeah, so when I look at resolutions, I actually stop with the, you know, oh, I want to lose weight. Oh, I want to, you know, get more fit. Oh, I want to, because a lot of times when I set those goals of that should be a lifestyle, it's more common than not to fall off, because it's, you know, especially at the beginning of the year, you know, went through Thanksgiving, you know, went through Christmas, you know, went through the New Year's, and oh, everybody didn't want to lose weight. You do that for maybe 4 to 8 weeks, and you back to your old habits, lifestyle. So for me, at the beginning of the year, I personally, you know, which should be a lifestyle as well, I personally, you know, just go into wanting to have a closer, every all the time, really, just wanting to make sure that I have a closer relationship with God. And the reason is, the reasoning why is because if I have the closer relationship with God, if it's getting my money in order, I understand that he's first, and I should pay my tithing first, and everything else, you know, is going to work itself out. You know, my money, if I make him first with my finances and my money, you know, I'm going to be okay. If when it comes to my body, if I understand that my body is a temple of God, I'm going to be careful of what I put in my body. I'm going to be careful, you know, what I drink, what I eat, you know what I'm saying, what I allow to get in my ear gates, you know, what my eye gates, all of those things, if I have that closer relationship with God. So I think that for me, that's the way I look at it, you know, so even with my attitude, if I have a closer relationship with God, he's going to convict me in my spirit if I have done something that was not lined up with his word or his will, you know. So it's all about that relationship, because in each area of our life, he's going to lead us, you know, in the way that we should go if we have the closer relationship and that closer walk with him. So that's my resolution at the beginning of the year. Lord, if I have fallen away from spending time with you, if I have fallen away from really just getting in the word of God, bring me back to that place. Because if I come back to that rightful place that I need to be, you're going to lead me. If I got a wrong attitude, my attitude is going to be changed. You know what I'm saying? If I need to work on my finances, you know, I trust and believe as I continue to pay my tithe, as I continue to pay my offering, you know, I don't have no need. You know what I'm saying? You're going to supply all of my needs, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm putting you first.
That's good. That's good. That kind of ties us in with the two topics, the resolution versus the direction of Christ. Like you said, you stopped doing just a resolution of what you wanted and went into saying, Lord, you direct my path. And so we're going to talk about that a little bit later. Pamela, did you want to add to anything that Keandra said?
Well, I definitely agree with her. I had in my notes too about lifestyle changes. That's what we need to look at. It's a daily walk. It's not just one time, because you're so right. People say something in January, and as soon as a few months go by, it's all over. That's because they were looking for something quick, and it's lifestyle is over time. It's our daily living or our daily walk. So mm-hmm. I agree totally.
And yes, that's absolutely. I think about even myself, you know, even having to get checkups, and a lot of people know that I, you know, have asthma. And so one of the things that with having that, you know, seasonal issues, I also have to watch what I'm eating, because I'm monitored, you know, my dad was diabetic, so I'm monitored for that. And so sometimes I know for me recently, I had to ask God, why do I want to go and get this? And you know what I'm saying? Sometimes you'll say, well, I want to eat this and I want to eat that. And you know, you have to watch what you're eating, because I know for me, the doctors are quick to grab a steroid and give it to you, especially with people that suffer with asthma. And so when you have that, you have to be very, very careful of the amount of carbs that you eat. And so sometimes you just want a piece of bread. Like you just want a piece of bread. And then I have to ask God, why do I keep going? I know it ain't supposed to eat all of this. So tell me why. So that's one of, like you all were saying, consulting Christ and asking God, you know, give me direction and help me to be disciplined. Help me to why do I feel like I need comfort foods or anything like that? So that's an example, I would say, for me. And I think we kind of answered the next question, which was, what are some of the examples of resolutions that we've made? So I think we answered that question. So we're going to go to the next question, which is, what are the dangers of making resolutions, separate from God's direction? What are the dangers of making resolutions separate from God's direction? And Pamela, you can take that one.
Okay, I'm going to read what I wrote because I don't want to miss anything. And then I may add to it. But I have, our plans don't always align with God's plans or directions. We want to do what we want to do. God may not honor or order our steps if we don't seek him first. If we don't get clarity or clear direction from God, we're out there basically on our own, just, you know, on a limb or being a renegade. His time is not our time and his thoughts are not our thoughts. But, you know, we want to do, or we're in our carnal mind, we're not seeking God. We may not have his blessing or his covering when we make resolutions or goals separate from God's direction. So if we do what we want and we don't seek God, then we expect or, you know, say, God, why didn't you bless this thing trying to do? But it may not be anything as to what God has for you to do. That may not be in the purpose or the plan that he has for you. So you can't just, you know, call God out and challenge him as to why he didn't make this work for you.
That's good. That's good. When you said the covering, we may not be covered. I happen to be reading the scripture. I've been studying two different topics. I've been studying this Bible study called Nowhere the Gods by Kelly Minter. And then I've been studying the topic of making God our hiding place. And so this morning I was reading it, and it's one of the reasons why we should make God our hiding place or our secret places, you know, where the scripture says going into the secret place and hiding and God covering you is when you come out from under that, we aren't covered. When we do it our way, that disobedience causes us to come from the covering of Christ. And so is it something that he would say it's okay to go after? And sometimes one of the resolutions, I know in the past, one of the resolutions have been, you know, I want to make more money. I want to do this. I want to do that. Well, how are you going to, have we consulted Christ in how to make the money? And the money comes in your purpose that he's placed inside of us. And so I was thinking about that when I was reading that scripture this morning, early this morning, where it talked about that part of the benefit of making God our hiding place or refuge is that we're covered, we're protected from dangers. Because when we make decisions, I was telling my teenager this the other day, as teenagers, you know, we've all been teenagers. And so they get to where I want to do what I want to do it my way. I want to know what, you know, my purpose, this is what I think I want to do. And I ask him, is that what God is saying to you? Is that what God said that's for you, that he's called you to do? And so a lot of times the world may say, let them do, you know, let them discover, but we have to direct them. And so it's the same thing with us. Are we directing, being directed by Christ? So I just wanted to add that. Keandria, we were talking about the question of the dangers of making resolutions separate from Christ.
But the danger is, first of all, it's like, for me, the danger is when you are not walking in the will of God and things begin to happen, I always feel convicted because I feel like I'm not covered. But when you know that you have that divine protection and you know that you are in the right place and knowing that God is leading you by his power and by his might, you know, you have no worries. You know what I'm saying? It says be anxious for nothing, you know. But when you know that you have neglected your first love, and when you know you have neglected the very one that's the head of your life, you become evicted, and you become to feel like, you know, well, you ask questions, you know, so you ask more questions than you need to because you feel like you're on the wrong path. And you just feel like you're not really connected. You're not covered. You know, so that's one of the dangers, because that disconnection, anytime you feel disconnected from anything, you feel left out. You feel like, you know, you have no assurance, you have no certainty, you don't have no clarity. So that is one of the dangers, you know, because he tells you to acknowledge him in all your ways. So if you're not making him part of your life, if you're not making him part of your walk, and if you're not making him part of everything that you do, of course, you know what I'm saying? We'll say, I'm going to make your path straight. You're not going to feel like your path is straight. You know, when he say, I'm going to work out those rough places, you're not going to feel like he's working out those rough places, because you have left him out. So that's dangerous, because you have, you know, you're not receiving his counsel. You're not allowing him to order your steps.
Amen, amen. And Pamela, I didn't know if you want to add to that before we go into the scriptures that we wanted to talk about. I don't know if you wanted to add to what she was saying.
Uh-oh. Well, we both emphasized the covering, and when mm-hmm. we don't have that covering, it leaves us open more for the enemy to come in. We already know the enemy is out there, but when you're not covered, just imagine how much more we leave ourselves open.
Absolutely. We do. We know, and we don't realize it. And I always go back, like I said, to the kids, because I'm teaching kids all day. And so it's God always take me back to the kids. Is what are the adults doing that's teaching the kids to go in their own direction versus, you know, seeking me? So that I just thought about that. So making sure that we seek him first, as the word says, and then he will provide whatever it is we need, and everything that we think that we can go after on our own, he can make it double what we think we can go after and seek on our own. So thank you for sharing that. So the scriptures, the first scripture that we will want to talk about is Psalm 32, and it's verses 7 through 8. Psalm 32, verses 7 through 8. And I'll read it, and then, Keandria, you can respond to it, and then we'll kind of piggyback. So Psalm 32, verses 7 through 8 says, and this is the New American Standard for people that are listening. This is the New American Standard Version. You are my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way which you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. So the key verse is, I will instruct you and teach you in the way which you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you.
All right, so I'm always I always go to something, you know, relatable, and you know, when I think about you know, the hiding place, him as a hiding place, you know, if you as a child or if you have kids, we all can relate to, you know, hide and seek, you know, and so we all, you know, we run and we find a hiding place, you know, so a lot of times. You run to the closet, because in the closet there's clothes, there's blankets, there's pillows, and those things kind of camouflage us, right? Kind of hide us. And so in our hiding, and with God, that's kind of what he do. He's that place where we can hide. He's that place that we feel safe. He's that place that we feel protected. And that divine protection, and him leading us by his power, you know, even in the darkest place, you know, he find that protection, like you feel safe, you know, even in that weak place, you feel safe, you know, he gives you that when you're weak, you know, he gives you that strength, and you like, Lord, where is strength coming from? And you know, when you feel like you in the midst of chaos, you know how you feel, and right now inside, like, I feel terrible, like, you know, I'm in a place of, you know, disaster, but because of his covering, you know, he brings you out, and nobody knows like exactly what you are going through, you know, because, and even when you're unsure of what's next, you know, he leads you, he guides you, he gives you instructions, you know what I'm saying? So when you start praying to him, when you start looking up to him, when you start talking to him, and I'm one that I just talk to him, I'll be like, okay, Lord, I really don't know what's going on right now. I have these mixed feelings. I have these mixed emotions. You know, I'm not really sure if I should go left, if I should go right, if I should go straight. You know, sometimes you just be like, okay, then you hear him, you speak, just be still. Be still. I got you. You know, and I'm like, okay, Lord, just lead me, guide me, give me instructions, give me something. And, you know, when you just get in that quiet place, you know, and just meditate on his word, you know, sometimes he'll just bring you to a scripture. You know, you be like, how I land on that scripture? You know, sometimes he'll just lead you to a person, and that person, that one person is speaking to your life, and you wasn't even, you know, expecting it. You know what I'm saying? That one person, it could be a word, you know, it can be a sign. It can be, you know, I could ride, I done rode down the road before when I just kind of was talking to God, and something I had rolled by more than once, never noticed it, it stick right out at me and give me instructions. Or give me some type of assurance. So it gives me something. So that's the type of God that we serve and we have a relationship with, because he gives us instruction. He guides us. He counsels us. You know what I'm saying? And in the midst of our chaos, you know, he covers us. And even in the midst of danger, he covers us. Like the things that are going on right now. You know, we just have to count our blessings. Everything may not be going the way we want it to go, but we have to count our blessings and know that he got us. You know, he said, I got you. Just trust me.
Amen. I totally agree. And as you were talking, that's what came to my spirit, was prayer and intimacy with God. And so we can't hear his instructions if all of the chatter is going on around us, if we're doing so much and you know, listening to the news, listening to this, listening to that. If there's so much going on around us, we can't hear him. And so that's what stood out to me in verse 8, where it says, I will instruct you and teach you. But if we're not in a position of being able to be instructed by God, because we can't hear him with the clatter of the world. I remember many years ago, a minister, she walked up to me and she said, there's a lot of clatter. She was prophesying to me. She said, there's a lot of clatter, a lot of noise around you. You can't hear God's voice. And I was like, what does that mean? And so she began to explain, it's getting quiet, getting in the, like the scripture says, a hiding place, the secret place of God. I really think that's the time we're in, that God is calling us to that secret place, that hiding place where he can hear, we can speak to him and he can hear, we can hear his voice. We can hear him speaking. A lot of times we go to church, and we've gone to church for many years, but I believe God is calling us to intimacy. You know what I'm saying? Still going to church, but that closer walk, that individual closer walk with him, because a lot of times we go to church and come back and God is still trying to get us to do something he's instructed us to do, but we haven't necessarily moved in it. And it could be because, you know, we may be saying, well, I'm doing this or I'm doing that, but what is he individually telling us to do? So I thought about that when you were speaking. So Pamela, I didn't know if you want to add to that.
Well, for the first part, for verse 7, that whole notion of the hiding place and the protection from trouble. And I just think about the newborn, how when we wrap the newborn in the blanket and it gives them that level of comfort and security. And I think of the words to the song, Safe in His Arms. So when we do have that level of closeness and closer relationship and that intimacy, when you're in his presence, you just feel that safety. The safety in his arms. And the second, the part about songs of deliverance just really stuck with me, because I sing and I'm a worshiper. So I have so many just songs in my head. And sometimes that's what it takes the scripture and a song are always a combination to me and the prayer. So they all kind of work together. The part about I will instruct you and teach you, what comes to mind to me is that we have to be in a place of being willing to be teachable or coachable, even in a practical life sense. I think about, I mentioned I have three sons. My youngest son, when he started playing football, one of the awards he won, and he was a little disappointed that he won the coach's award for being coachable. He thought he should have won some other distinction or other category. But the coach and his brothers and I explained to him that that was significant for you to be coachable. That meant the coach saw some potential in you and that you would listen and follow the instructions. Like, God wants us to listen and follow his instructions. But, you know, some of us in life, we're just hard-headed and won't do what we want to do. But to be coachable, that's how we're going to be counseled, and he's going to keep his eye on us. We're going to grow and develop because we're coachable or we're teachable. We're willing. So I'm going to leave it right there.
That was good. That was good. Being coachable, because God is a gentleman. So he doesn't push things on us. He wants to us to surrender to it. Even with somebody, I think about, okay, I don't know why LeBron name just came to my head, but as famous as he is, he can be coachable sometimes. And then there are times, you know, because he knows so much. So being, even no matter where you go, how high you go, God is saying, you know what I'm saying? If no matter how high he takes you, you still have to be at that place of humility to be able to still learn something from him. So that was good. All right. So the second scripture is Psalm 37, starting at verse 5. So it's verse 5 and 7. And then it goes into verses 23 and 24. So I just kind of pulled those out. So again, Psalm 37, 5 and 7, and then 23 and 24. And I'll read it, and then Pamela, you can respond to this one first. So it says in verse 5, again, the New American Standard Version, it says, "Commit your way to the Lord, trust also in him, and he will do it." Verse 7 says, "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who carries out wicked schemes." And then it goes down to verse, I just kind of pulled out the things that stood out to me. "The steps of a man are established by the Lord, and he delights in his way. When he falls, he will not be hurled headlong, because the Lord is the one who holds his hand." And so I'll read those four again. They kind of, okay, so verse 5 says, "Commit your way to the Lord, trust also in him, and he will do it." Verse 7 says, "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who carries out wicked schemes." And then we go down to verse 23 and 24, and it says, "The steps of a man are established by the Lord, and he delights in his way. When he falls, he will not be hurled headlong." And I just picture somebody tumbling downstairs when I read that part. And then it says, "Because the Lord is the one who holds his hand." And so, Pamela, I know it was several, but tell me what you're thinking.
Okay, first thing, I want to just read something from the Tony Evans Bible. And it's, I don't think it's coincidental. I think it's intentional that he has these passages throughout that say hope words. And it definitely makes me think of the ministry, Hope in Christ. So the one for this passage says, don't worry about locating your purpose if you are seeking after God, because your purpose will locate you. Mm-hmm. And that kind of tied into us talking about resolutions. So we don't need to worry about the resolution if we're seeking after God. Our purpose is going to locate us, kind of like your gift will make room for you. But what sticks out with me on these four verses, committing our way to the Lord and trusting in him, and he's going to do it. He's going to make us to succeed. We're going to be victorious if we commit our way to him first. The be still and waiting, that's one that some of us struggle with, is first of all being still and then waiting patiently. Because when we're waiting, some of us can't wait. We still have to try to, you know, help God out or do something. Like we say we're going to wait on him, but we're really not waiting on him, not waiting patiently. But when you wait patiently on something, you're expecting it. You're expecting it to happen. You have a sense of anticipation, and you're not nervous and anxious about it. You believe God is going to do it because he said he did. He would. Don't fret because of other people's success. That reminds me of comparison. Sometimes we compare ourselves to other people, but what God has for you is for you, and what he has for me is for me. And our blessings might come in different forms. And as soon as you start comparing yourself to somebody else, whether it's in ministry, in the world, that's when you run into trouble. There should be no competition in Christ. One of my kingdom sisters said that to me, and that just really stuck with me, that there should be no competition in Christ. It's enough souls out here for us to, you know, minister to, witness to. You can reach somebody I can't reach, and I might minister to somebody that you can't reach. The Lord makes our step, I'm sorry, the Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him. To me, that's basically intentional. He's guiding you in the exact way. It's a firm foundation means just that. It's not wishy-washy. You're not going to put your foot down and sink. He's not going to cause you to fall. But if you do happen to fall, he's going to be right there. Like the sister said, God's got us. He's going to catch us. If we put him first and we're seeking after him, we're going after the steps that he ordered us to follow, then we don't have to worry. We're going to go along the path. God is going to guide us. He's going to keep us along the way. He's not going to let us fall. We won't fail if we operate in Christ.
Keandrea, did you want to add to that?
She said it all, but I mean, I will say, when it comes to trusting in his way, we have to get out of our way. A lot of times, you know, that's back to the, you know, the resolutions, is a lot of times we'll find ourselves saying, and, you know, not seeking his way and seeking his will. And I know a lot of times, you know, when we're going through things, and, you know, when you're talking about purpose, and we're talking about him upholding us, a lot of things that we go through, I believe that we go through for a reason. And all that we go through, there's a reason, you know what I'm saying? And so whether it's trying to strengthen us, whether it's trying to develop our character, you know, whether, you know, it's a test, for a testimony to help someone else that's going through mm-hmm. something that, you know, that you're going through, or maybe you're going through it and you have overcame it, and, you know, now someone else is experiencing the same pain, that same struggle, that same difficulty, that same depression, that same anxiety. But because you have overcame that that place, you are now able to minister to them. So that is part of your purpose. You know, that is part of your purpose. And in our falling, that only puts us in a place for us to have faith. For us to have faith, because, you know, we have to sometimes come to him like a little child. You know, like a little child. We have to come to him because, you know, we get to the place where we think we know it all. You know what I'm saying? He was like, no. I need you to come to me, my child. You know, let's have a talk. I need you to come to me, my child. Let's have a conversation. I need you to come to me, my child. You know, because now you're doing things within your own means. And when you do things within your own means, you know, you mess up. You know, and it's common for us to mess up. But the problem is when we mess up, you know, we try to fix it ourselves. You know, we think we know all the answers. We think we know all the solutions, you know. Instead of coming to him and having that conversation with him. And that's, you know, when we, and then when we do fall, the danger is when we do fall, sometimes we feel like we're down longer than we should be down. You know, we covered up and balled up and, you know, now we vent into everybody except for who? Except God. You know, but he's telling us to trust him. You know what I'm saying? And at the end of the day, just having a relationship, you know what I'm saying? Not being afraid to talk to him, you know what I'm saying? Because I think a lot of times people just make it complicated. I used to make it complicated, even with praying, you know what I'm saying? It was like, you're just talking to God, talk to him. You know, he's no strange person. You know, he created you. He know you. He knew you before the womb. You know, so he know the number of hairs you have on your head. You know, so you're no stranger to him, but he's just waiting for you to invite him in to what you have going on, so he can uphold you, so you don't fall and stay down. You know, pick up your mat. You got to pick up your mat. Can't stay there. You can't stay balled up. You know, you can't run around venting to everybody except for the number one creator. But he's giving us that assurance and that confidence in him that he can deliver us, that he can uphold us, that he can protect us, that he can, you know, give us, you know, he can give us what it is that he know that we need. Everything that we think we need, we may not need. And that's where the patience comes in.
Amen.
That's where the patience comes in, that we got to be patient.
Amen. And as both of you are talking, I like to look at practical examples as well. And when it was saying the scripture, verse 5 says, commit your way to the Lord, trust him and he will do it. I was thinking about sometimes, and thinking from being an author standpoint, sometimes we may say, well, I'm going to commit. I'm going to make a resolution. I'm going to try to sell this many books. Instead of saying, God, I commit this all to you. I commit this to you, and I trust that you're going to do with it what you said you're going to do with it, and more than what I could ever do with it. And so, and even I think about, even when I sit down and I start writing, is it what God said to write? You know, is it what God is putting and placing in my spirit to write, or is it something that, the world says you're going to get this many sales because of this? You know, sometimes people, as writers, we have to be careful. As Christian writers, we have to be careful of not getting into that as well. So I thought about that when it was saying committing your way to the Lord, because we can make a resolve or make a resolution to say, I'm going to do this. But is that the direction God is sending you in? Is that what God told you to do? With the gift that he put in you. All right. So I didn't know if anybody want to piggyback before we go to that next scripture, and then we're going to close it out. I don't know if anybody want to piggyback on that.
No.
All right. So our next scripture is, and the last one that we're going to do is, we're going to go to Proverbs 16 and 9. Proverbs 16 and 9. And those that are listening, we can, you know, I like to click on the scripture and go to it. So if you have your Bible, go to Proverbs 16 and 9. And that verse simply says, give instruction to a wise man and he will be still wiser. teach a righteous man and he will increase his learning. So anybody that want to jump on that, Keandria, did you want to respond to that? It says, give instruction to a wise man and he will be still wiser. Teach a righteous man and he will increase his learning. And then it goes on, I'm sorry, verse 10 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So I love to, since I saw that pop out at me, I want to read that one too.
Yeah, when you, I mean, the first thing that comes to my mind, really, to be honest, is when it says, when you lack knowledge, you get understanding. And a lot of times, I mean, that's just it. You know, when everything that you get understanding. If you don't understand it, if you lack the knowledge, because we are, a lot of times we are destroyed by the lack of knowledge. But even still, with the knowledge, when you think that you have so much knowledge that, you know, God doesn't exist, you know, I believe sometimes that can he put you in a place where you didn't feel like you're foolish. So, but we just have to be careful. Be careful even with the knowledge, and in the knowledge, make sure that you get understanding. And so that's one thing that I personally have been really working on too, even with just the relationship, you know, that when, you know, when I'm reading the Bible, or even when my worship and my praise, and you just have to be really careful to the words that's spoken in the songs, because we can a lot of times get hyped up off of the songs, because it's, you know, it feels good to the ear, and it's something that I like music to have a little bit upbeat to it. But even with the upbeat of the songs, you have to listen to the words. And when you tune in to the words and you realize that that's not true, you know, then it kind of turns you away, you know, then it turns you away from singing that song, or, you know, because you have really just tuned in. Because a lot of times, you know, she was talking about all the noise. A lot of times, you know, in addition to the noise, in with the music and with the songs, you know, you just so in the hypeness of what you think is true, until you come to a calm place and you really just tune in, and you be like, that ain't what I need to be singing. That ain't what I need to be saying. But you know, back to, you know, what you were saying, is just in everything that you get, you know, get understanding. And that's what came to me. That's what came to me.
Amen. Amen. And Pamela, did you want to piggyback off of that, the scripture, give instruction to a wise man and he will be still wiser. Teach a righteous man and he will increase his learning. And then one of my favorite verses after that is, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
The distinction between wisdom and knowledge, and people who say they're just smart. So wisdom has nothing to do with how smart you are. And the fact that wisdom is where it all begins. When we get the knowledge of Christ, when we come into the knowledge of Christ, that's when we are coming into the wisdom, how to make wise decisions. And what stuck out to me, Keandria, is that how you pronounce it?
Yes.
I'm sorry. When you were talking about the music, I'm very intentional on looking up lyrics, because I want to make sure that the lyrics speak the message of Christ. Even with Christian or, you know, gospel music, we definitely have to be careful, because sometimes, like you said, the lyrics don't match up with scripture or don't match up with the word. But we just be singing it, or, you know, just that music, that beat draws you in. But what do the lyrics say? When I first started just writing and being intentional, one of the things I used to do when I commute to work, I'm working at home now, but this is my life application part of this. I would get on the commuter bus in the morning and I would post a YouTube link to a song. So I have my short prayer. I would write out a scripture, and I would look for a song. But before I posted the song, I looked up the lyrics, and I would put some of the lyrics in the message, because I don't want people to just hear the song and hear the music. I wanted you to hear what the words were saying, so that you would know that this is what safe in his arms really means. This is what it says. Or, you know, those hymns and things like that. This is the music, or this is the message that's going to carry us through. So while you meditate on that scripture, while you have your prayer time, these words are going to be the things that, if you get that song stuck in your head, I want you to get a song stuck in your head that's going to do something for you in your spirit, not just some nonsense song. So definitely being intentional and being wise is what we need to do in our daily walk. All about, like you said, that lifestyle.
Amen. As you were talking, I love music. I love gospel music. I love, I walk around the house singing. And there's a song, it's a gospel song, and I was singing it one, just singing it all loud and just, and I started thinking about the words. Wait a minute. And the way the song was, you know, they were saying, Lord, whatever you're doing in this season, please don't do it without me, you know, be healing in this season. I said, hold on, wait a minute. That's not scripture. Because God is always healing. God is always delivering. God is always, he doesn't stop. And so I really stopped. I caught myself with that song because we don't have to ask him to heal us. We don't have to. We just go in prayer, and he's still forever healing. He never stopped healing. He never stopped delivering, you know. And so when I was singing that, it just, y'all just made me think about that. And then even some of the works that, you know, how the Bible describes heaven and some of the songs that's out there that, you know, you're like, wait a minute, is that what the Bible say about heaven? So you really have to really pay attention to what you're listening to, because the beat does sound good. And you start singing and lifting your hands and you're like, wait a minute, that don't line up with the word. So that's very, very key. And like you said, being wise, getting wisdom from God. I always love the scripture, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, because when we fear God, we know we don't question his word. I just wanted to, that came to my spirit. When we fear God, we don't question his word. I've seen situations where there's like literal arguments about what's in scripture. That's not we don't even have to have a conversation about that because we're not God. And so I tell people, even as, you know, a minister, even with my podcast, even if I'm teaching something, if I'm teaching, you know, the biblical literacy, I tell people all the time, listen, before we even start, we are not getting ready to debate the scriptures. Because there's this, you know, there's that new thing out here where, you know, there's so much questions, and I'm like, Lord, and God just dropped it in my spirit from that scripture, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Because when we fear him, we don't say things just like out of the way about the scripture, about the Holy Spirit, about Christ, because we know that he alone is. And so I just wanted to share that and to ask you if you have any other comments that you want to close out with, that you want to leave the listeners with. I know who wanted to go first.
I can. I just, as we have went through, you know, this conversation tonight, one thing, you know, we in February now. Time is moving. I'm like, we in February already, you know. So anyway, just relationship. I can't stress it enough, you know. Just the relationship and just meditating on his word day and night, and just speaking life into yourself. And you know, he gives us the help that we need, you know. That's why he says seek him first. And you know, when we wake up in the mornings, and don't make him the last, make him the first. You know, a lot of times we immediately get up in the mornings and our task. We done got into our task, and before we think about this, it's midday. It'd be like, oh, good morning, Lord. You know, and so we ask for so many things.
And the Lord, he blesses us where he see fit. You know, everything that we ask for, we may not receive. And it doesn't mean that it's not meant for us. Many times it is. It's timing, you know, that we talked about patience. You know, a lot of times it's seed time and harvest. You know, and that's, again, you know, as a part of your resolution, you know, while you're trying to get fit, don't forget about paying your tithes. You know, make him first. You know, when you creating that budget, when you get paid and you start writing down in your book, make him first. You know, we ask them for a lot of things. You know, people ask them for clothes, cars, houses. You know, Lord, do it for me. He gonna do it for you, but make him first and not last. You know, and so that's we need to add that to our resolution. You know what I'm saying? Because we don't need to leave him out. That's the point. You know. Resolution versus the way of Christ. And so we're gonna walk the way, we're gonna be the way in actions, you know, not just talk, but in action. So that let us be transformed by the renewing of our mind, you know, in 2021.
So I definitely agree. And I kind of thought of what you said at the end, the phrase that says, don't just talk about it, be about it. So actually do that thing. If you are saying something, to actually do it, actually follow through. And I just have one other hope words. It says, God has your tomorrow covered. Even though you haven't been there yet, he's got the plan. So it's wraps up what we're talking about with our resolutions. We are so busy trying to get there and get there, but God already has a plan for us if we will just follow it, his plan, not our plan, but definitely seek God first. And we know that we can do all things, but we've got to put God first and seek him first, truly. And then our life will reflect it. Our life will reflect it if we do just that. It won't be as hard as we make it. And we'll do what God says to do.
Amen, amen. And I want to close with similar to what these awesome young ladies have said. One of the things, as both of you were talking, just to close out, I've done, I think this is my 21st year in education, but at some point I decided I was going to leave education because I was tired of politics. And so I went all the way to a school. Like, I went to go get my master's degree, and I was going to leave education. I was going to go into a whole nother program, and God let me sit right there in that program, and I was miserable. And God kept saying, you finish? Mm-hmm. When you get finished, you're going to do what I told you to do. And he's always called me to education. And so I had taken classes. I was failing the classes, all kinds of stuff. I was miserable. And so I said that to say that whatever we're doing, to even in our anger, even in our frustration, if we're doing it opposite of God, it's not going to work. It won't work. I tried it. And as soon as I changed the program and I went into education, I got my degree in education. God said, okay, now you're being obedient. And it was like a breeze. The whole program was a breeze. And I say that to whoever's listening to me, that when God gives you the grace to do it, if he put that purpose in you, he will equip you to get through it. It is easy. A lot of times people say, how do you do this? How do you do that? And I always say it is nobody but Jesus. It is him, because doing what we're doing right now, spreading the gospel, that's not work to me. Writing for Christ, that's not work to me. Teaching young people and being that light for Christ in the classroom, that's not work for me. So when we're trying to do work, we're trying to do something in our own strength. That's when it's not Christ, and it seems like it's too much, and it seems like it's too hard. because it's not what he told us to do. So I say that to the people that are listening to me, the people that are listening to the playback, that whatever God said do, he already have you equipped to do it. He already put it in you. He just wants to use you. He just wants to work through you, because he's not going to give you the glory. He's going to be glorified in your life. And so I just wanted to end with that. And before we close out, we're going to close out with prayer. Father, we thank you, God, for just this awesome conversation. God, we thank you, Lord, for your women of God. We pray for those that are listening. We pray, oh God, for a blessing, a covering over your women of God, that they will continue to spread your light, oh God, and be the light in darkness, God. We just thank you, oh God, for everything that you've called us to do. I pray that those that are listening, that they would walk in it, and that there won't be resolution, my resolution, but your direction. So, Father, we give you glory. We give you honor, and we give you praise because we know that we are your creation. We are called to your purpose and your destiny. And so we pray that we would surrender our hearts to do what you have called us to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And again, thank you all for tuning in to Hope in Christ with Denise here on Kingdom Influencers Broadcast. Have a phenomenal rest of your week.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies.